Hey guys, Zack Mars here, and this is my review of Gravity Falls. Okay, so we are officially in day 8 of Gravity Falls month, and this episode, Little Dipper, is a fun one to start off on. So, essentially, the whole premise surrounding it is that, you know, Dipper becomes insecure about his height, is essentially what the premise is, and Gideon kind of takes advantage of that. This is like his second major appearance in this series, in a show where he's kind of, you know, set up to be the main bad guy, at least for right now. But, yeah, this is a second major appearance, and it's a pretty fun appearance of Gideon, because, honestly, he's very unhinged in this episode. I kind of like it. But, overall, this episode's fun, because, you know, does come up with some pretty interesting, you know, kind of stuff. But also kind of sets up Gideon's main motivation going forward, which is something that they definitely needed to do, like, they established that, you know, he and Stan had a rivalry, but his main motivation had been unclear up until now. Now we have an idea of what his main motivation is. But, yeah, ultimately, the episode does wind up opening up with, you know, Gideon in his room, kind of scheming of ways to get back to the Pines family, but every idea that he has doesn't really work. Like, he's going through, like, a list of spells and other things in his journal, which, of course, is the matching, you know, twin to Dipper's journal. But he's going through it. He's kind of crossing out little ideas, being like, oh, zombies, they don't listen to you, like, get rid of it. Demon Calipari, get rid of it. He's going through his list of things that he knows he can do with his journal, and he's not finding anything that particularly noteworthy. And ultimately, getting frustrated, he concludes that, you know, there has to be something that he can do that, you know, will enable him to get revenge on the Pines family, but remarks that revenge isn't enough and that he needs to take something from them, something that he'll give him power. At which point, he remembers that he made a replica out of popsicle sticks of the Mystery Shack, and realizing that's the perfect idea, and he ultimately decides that he's going to go after the Shack. So, of course, it cuts away to, you know, the Pines at home, just celebrating their day, just kind of sitting down, watching TV. They're watching an episode of Duck Detective. But ultimately, there's suddenly a knock at the door, and Stan immediately goes into it, he immediately goes into his, you know, Mr. Mystery shtick, where he starts offering the guy at the door, you know, a tour of their place and all the other things. But then the guy kind of says Stan's full legal name, which causes him to immediately become concerned. He immediately believes that it's a tax collector and that they finally found him. So he immediately uses a smoke bomb to cover his tracks, runs into the living room to swipe a duffel bag full of money, and then starts feeling around for a trap door, which is fun. But ultimately, the guy reveals that he's not actually there for Stan because of money that he's owed. It's actually revealed that he's there because he's, quote unquote, according to himself, he's from the big money coupon saver winners contest, and that he has won $1 million. Which, of course, Stan is very much moved by the idea that, you know, his dream to own money has finally come true. While Dipper and Mabel are happy about the fact that they're, you know, rich. But it's at this point where they hand him the paperwork, and Stan seemingly signs it. Only for it to be revealed that this was all a ruse by Gideon, and Stan not only didn't win anything, but he reveals that he just tricked Stan into signing the shack over to him. Which, of course, causes Dipper and Mabel to become immediately concerned as, you know, Gideon does a happy little tap dance to kind of, you know, represent the fact that, hey, I finally won. But then Stan reveals that actually he knew what Gideon, Iwika was kind of ahead of the curve on Gideon, because he reveals that, you know, he didn't actually sign away anything. And tells Gideon to take a closer look at the signature, at which point, you know, he then starts reading it out loud, and it's revealed that he just signed it, "Suck a lemon, little man." Which of course causes, you know, Gideon to fly into a rage against Stan, pointing out that, you know, that the shack will be his. And also the process, there's a really fun improv line from Thurup, the guy who voiced him, Thurup Van Offerman, who is the voice of I don't know how to pronounce his name. I know that he was the voice of Flapjack, if that helps, but also Gideon. He, of course, insists that, you know, when there's an improv line where he tells the guy, the quote unquote money guy, to give him a, you know, a lift, and telling him he quote unquote needs his arms. At which point, you know, the guy picks him up and he tells Stan that he'll rue the day, he'll mess with him, and that when he least suspects it, he will in fact take the shack and sweep it out from under the rug from, you know, Stan and his family, claiming that he will eventually destroy them. Meanwhile, Stan and the kids aren't particularly concerned and decide to go back to figuring out what else is on TV. With a bit of a gag about, you know, the theme song being Mabel's favorite part, which, you know, then immediately goes into the theme song. So it's a funny little the theme song for this show is a lot of people's favorite. I'll be perfectly honest. This is a really good theme song. It really is. But ultimately it's at this point where, you know, kind of going about the rest of their day, you know, Zipper and Mabel then proceed to start playing a game of chess in the gift shop while, you know, Seuss is working. He's hanging up shelves, fixing other shelves that are loose, you know, those kinds of things. He's just going about his business. And while Dipper and Mabel are trying to play a game of chess, more so Dipper than Mabel, because while Dipper and Mabel are of equal intelligence, Mabel will not play, you know, intellectual games. There's a difference there. Mabel's more, you know, Dipper's of course the straight man Mabel's more the creative, you know, type kind of person. And so she is not really thinking about playing chess legit. But we find out she is, you know, not only moving pieces that aren't her color, but she also keeps scooping up the knights, because she likes gathering up the little horses in her little shirt pouch. But of course, Dipper then proceeds to, you know, remark that, you know, that if she's not going to take the game seriously, then, you know, he just wins. Like, literally, she's not paying attention, and so Dipper kind of wins rather easily. So he's just kind of tallies that down in his notebook of all the times he's won. Unfortunately for Mabel, she has not won a single time against Dipper in any game of chess that they played. But what happens that starts the conflict of the episode is that as they're kind of wrapping up their game, Seuss tells them to ask Mabel if she can hand him, you know, the brain in a jar that they use as a prop on one of the shelves. And of course, Dipper gets up to volunteer and get it, but that's at this point where Seuss remarks that no, actually, he wants Mabel specifically because she's taller. This, of course, causes Dipper to become concerned, because he, according to himself, he and Mabel have always been the same height, but of course, Seuss, being a handyman, is kind of like, no, actually, I can kind of eyeball it and know you're not the same height. So of course, to kind of prove it, he pulls out a tape measure, and sure enough, Mabel is a millimeter taller than Dipper, which of course Mabel immediately takes with glee, and she starts, you know. This, of course, causes Dipper to become, you know, kind of point out that this makes no sense, pointing out that they've always been the same height, but Mabel just points out that this makes her the quote-unquote alpha twin, because, you know, she's had her growth spurt and now she's going to become taller, and, of course, does remark that she's going to, you know, eventually be taller, and then proceeds to make a bunch of height jokes in reference to Dipper. Like, throughout the entirety of the episode, she starts making height jokes, And of course, this eventually wakes up Stan from his nap in the other room, who comes in and asks where the object of ridicule is. At which point, she gestures a Dipper, and then Stan kind of gangs up. Mabel just kind of gang up on Dipper, kind of making a series of short jokes. Seuss, of course, tries to come to Dipper's defense, pointing out that, you know, to lighten up a little, which, of course, Stan kind of interprets as Seuss playing along and making fun of him. But, of course, they point out that Dipper will forget eventually because, you know, he has a quote-unquote short-term memory. But, yeah, it's just a series of hype jokes at Dipper's expense, and he eventually gets frustrated and goes upstairs. At which point he points out that he's kind of frustrated about the fact that, you know, they're constantly making fun of him for being short, even though he's not really that short compared to Mabel. So, he goes to go get his journal to look for a solution, discovers it's on the top shelf and he can't quite reach it by himself, but he ultimately is able to get it down from the shelf and starts looking through it. And eventually, he does discover something that could potentially help, you know, Mabel lighten up on the whole short joke thing. As he's looking through it, he eventually discovers a passage on a series of height-altering crystals, with the author having recorded rumors of beasts, both big and small, when they're not supposed to be that particular size. He's noted there's, you know, giant small bears, giant caterpillars. It ultimately concluded that there's some sort of height-altering property some deep in the woods. So Dipper, taking the author at his word, proceeds to go look for it in the wilderness somewhere. And unfortunately, he does sort of find it, where he discovers, you know, a couple of small... He starts following them until he starts seeing some small animals, which, of course, Dipper makes him realize he's in the right place. But then he sees a mountain cougar, which, of course, he proceeds to believe is either small or in perspective. It then proceeds to attack him, and Dipper realizes it's only perspective that it's small, and it does almost kill Dipper until it walks through a beam of light, shrinks down to a minuscule size, and while it still very much tries to, you know, maul Dipper to death, it's small and tiny now, so it can't do that. So, which, of course, Dipper comments that, you know, it still hurts, but less. At which point, he eventually follows the source of the beam of light, And discovers a butterfly passing through it. So he eventually discovers the beam of light, and sure enough, discovers a small little cluster of crystals that do in fact bestow shrinking and growing properties depending on how the light passes through them. So he proceeds to pull out his Swiss Army knife. And proceeds to dislodge one of the crystals. At which point, he brings it home with him, and duct tapes it to a flashlight with a piece of string to make a rudimentary shrink ray. Essentially, when he flips it and turns on the flashlight, it'll make things shrink. When he flips it the other way and turns on the flashlight, it'll make things grow. Here's the point: he tests it out using his chess set, which unfortunately breaks the ceiling of the mystery shack because he accidentally makes one of the pawns too big, but he is successful in his mission, and now satisfied, he uses it on himself and goes downstairs and to show Mabel. Meanwhile, Stan gets another knock at the door, and it's quickly discovered that Gideon is back with yet another scheme, this time revealing that he's brought an entire jar of termites and a baseball bat. And then declares and tells Stan that if he doesn't give up the deed to the mystery shack, that he will break the jar with the baseball bat he's carrying, and get sick the termites on the mystery shack. Stan, of course, then proceeds to break the jar in Gideon's despite Gideon, and in the process, the termites wind up attacking him instead because he's holding a wooden baseball bat, and they proceed to chase after him to get after the wood. So, of course, Gideon is frustrated, of course, because, you know, he's being attacked by termites, who are, you know, all tearing up his suit and his hair, meanwhile, Stan just kind of laughs at his misfortune, because, you know, he's giddy about the fact that he got one up on his nemesis, and the fact that it blew up, he did exactly what Gideon was setting out to do, and it blew up in Gideon's face is funny and ironic. It's great. But of course, Gideon, you know, hollers at Stan that his family has a weakness, and he will eventually figure out what that is. But of course, this is this point where you know, Stan just kind of goes back inside and hollers for Seuss to get the camera. So it's pretty funny that he messes with Gideon in a way that, you know, kind of bites Gideon back in the ass. It's fun. But meanwhile, Dipper goes to go find Seuss and Mabel, and Seuss realizes that, you know, Dipper has since grown another millimeter. Much to Mabel's confusion, and sure enough, when Seuss measures them again, it is confirmed that, yeah, they're the same height now. Which of course causes Mabel to briefly become concerned, but then points out that she's not super concerned about Dipper becoming taller than her, pointing out that, you know, she had her growth spurt first, which means that she's still going to be the alpha twin. And of course, this causes Dipper to become frustrated because, you know, they were the same height now, and Mabel still insists that she's going to be taller than him eventually. So he proceeds to, you know, declare that he's going to go have another growth spurt and runs back upstairs, much to, you know, Mabel's immediate confusion because she realizes now that Dipper is up to something. So she does, of course, you know, follow Dipper upstairs, where she's obviously, you know, trying to figure out what exactly it is that Dipper is up to. But ultimately, what happens is she does eventually corner Dipper, but Dipper by this point has used the shrink ray to once again make himself taller than Mabel, and she is, of course, not really really confused as to what's happening, but ultimately concludes, albeit incorrectly, that Dipper is using some sort of magic-y thing to make himself taller than her, and inaccurately concludes that it must be some sort of wizard that's using magic on Dipper to make himself taller. Dipper, of course, is insistent that there is no wizard and that she's, you know, kind of crazy. But of course, she then proceeds to open the closet and claims it's an invisible wizard, which of course isn't entirely inaccurate because it is revealed that invisible wizards exist in the novels, but not in this case. But yeah, it's fun because, you know, they've seen a couple of things at this point, so she would have, of course, immediately go to the idea that it must be some sort of wizard. But of course, eventually, after, you know, Mabel tries and fails to get some sort of, you know, magic spell out of the wizard, out of the quote-unquote wizard, Dipper then proceeds to reveal that it's not a wizard, that he created a rudimentary shrink ray with, you know, a flashlight and a crystal he found. Which, of course, she immediately steals once she realizes what Dipper's done. And she immediately runs off with it while the two of them proceed to fight over it. And of course, they do fight in the, you know, outside in the front lawn, which is, you know, fun. But they ultimately discover, Mabel, of course, grows her hand too big. So Dipper then proceeds to, you know, use it to shrink her hand, to reassuring her that it's okay and that it'll fix her hand no problem, pointing out that it shrinks things too. At which point she cry chops this out of his hands, and they continue to just fight over it, shrinking and growing various body parts, as well as making a giant caterpillar that just kind of wanders off into the forest. We never really see what happens with that. But, yeah, they do start fighting over it. Meanwhile, inside, I believe at this point, you know, they're working on, I believe that Seuss and Stan have since started working on, I don't remember specifically when this happens. I do remember at some point they start working on some sort of project in the, you know, in the Mystery Shack, where they use Stan's parlor to create a maze of mirrors, with Stan confirming that it is Seuss's greatest idea that he's taking credit for yet, which at which point he also proceeds to look in the mirror, notes that he asks if his ears have always been that big, and then proceeds to take his fez off to go wash up. At which point, Seuss, this is kind of an interesting thing that kind of gives Seuss a little bit more depth, but Seuss, as the second Stan leaves, takes the fez, puts his own hat in his pocket, places the fez on his head, and then proudly admires himself in the mirror, declaring someday, which, you know, implies that he would one day want to take over for Stan, which, you know, given how hard Seuss works, kind of makes sense. It's a little thing, but it does give Seuss a bit more depth. But eventually, Snipper and Mabel continue to fight over the shrink ray, when it eventually lands in front of Gideon, who is very much still stewing over his defeat by Stan, and he remarks that to himself about how he wishes he could find a way to get back at Stan, and that Stan will pay for what he did to him, and finally figure out how to get the shack. At which point, he discovers a flashlight and wonders what sort of thing it is. And of course, Mabel then whispers to Dipper, hoping that, maybe Gideon didn't see them use the flashlight and that he may not realize it's some sort of magic-y thing. Of course, she whispers that right in front of Gideon, who immediately figures out it's a shrink ray and uses the flashlight to, reduce Dipper and Mabel down to minuscule size before trapping them in the jar that he brought. So unfortunately, he proceeds to kidnap Dipper and Mabel and brings them back to his house, where we do find out a little bit more about his home life, and his home life isn't super great. So first things first, we do discover that his father Bud runs a discount car dealership out of the backyard, which is implied to be where the tent to telepathy is set up, since we see it in a car lot. So it's implied that it's set up somewhere in the parking lot of the used car dealership. But ultimately, Gideon comes home, and of course his father's in the middle of selling a used car to a bunch of people, where the hubcap falls off and it's revealed to have a possum in the engine, but that winds up just getting an enthused McGucket to buy it, and he winds up getting everybody else to buy it to buy it as well. Because, if McGucket wants it, then sure, everybody else will want it as well. But, of course, Gideon proceeds to come home with, the jar that contained the twins tucked under his arm. And of course, Bud asks him what sort of thing he's got tucked under his arm there. At which point, Gideon claims it's his little secret, which causes everybody, swoon over him because it's Gideon. But he immediately starts to go upstairs and calls them all a bunch of mouth-breathing fools once he's out of earshot of them. We go inside and we meet Gideon's mom, and she is notably extremely high-strung, which makes sense when you consider what she gave birth to. But of course, he just utters a half-hearted mother, at which point, he immediately runs upstairs and opens the jar to let Dipper Mabel out on his desk. And of course, this causes the two of them to become immediately concerned for their safety, with Mabel wondering what exactly is they're going to do with them. But ultimately, Gideon reveals that he's not going to do anything to Mabel as long as she agrees to be his queen. Which, of course, Mabel points out for two reasons. One, she's freaked out by Gideon, but also two, they live in a democracy, so she'd never be his queen anyway. But, it's at this point where Gideon, tells Mabel that maybe she'll change her mind after he shows her what he's got planned for her. And of course, he immediately picks her up. She starts declaring that she'll fight him until the day she dies. But it's revealed that Gideon just kind of drops her in a bag of gummy koalas and completely pacifies her that way. So it's very in character for Mabel to do that. But ultimately, once he's isolated and pacified Mabel, Gideon then turns his attention to Dipper and quickly realizes that Dipper had to have figured out how to make the shrink ray flashlight from somewhere. And does start questioning about whether or not he read it from somewhere, and if someone told him about it. Dipper, of course, realizes that Gideon might know about his journal, but realizing he can't let Gideon know that that's where he got the information from, he then proceeds to tell Gideon to quote unquote lean closer and he'll tell him. At which point he blows an ear horn in Gideon's ear, which causes Gideon to, of course, fly off the handle and insist that he has half a mind to squash Dipper right then and there, but then stops himself and realizes that he can use Dipper and Mabel, which It's a really funny little, you know, face drawn. It's a really great face. Like, it's just this really creepy face that I just love. But, of course, at this point where he calls, you know, Stan, who is obviously in the middle of his, you know, null mirrors thing with Seuss that he's building. And he then proceeds to, you know, he still doesn't have his fez on at this point, but he goes on, he picks up the phone from Gideon, who then proceeds to tell him, you know, that he has his niece and nephew hostage, and that if he wants to see them again, he'll hand over the shack. And before ultimately having to clarify that it's Gideon, because, you know, they can't tell. But this, of course, causes Stan to just, you know, laugh him off, claiming that this is obviously a fake, you know, ransom thing. Because he just saw Dipper and Mabel playing out in the yard not 5 minutes ago. So, he of course points out that, you know, there's no way Gideon has taken them hostage. He of course doesn't realize that Gideon has actually taken them hostage, but, you know, he's not really threatened by Gideon. But this of course causes Gideon to become really frustrated and throw his phone against the wall, but then starts laughing to himself once he realizes how stupid he's being. And then comes up with a brilliant plan to finally get the shack, which is to use the shrink ray to shrink Stan and then trap you know all three pines in his room. This of course causes but of course points out that if they go on a line, that he can just, you know, break them, which he demonstrates with, you know, His little popsicle stick dolls that he made of them in his previous episode. So yeah, Dipper and Mabel immediately become concerned for their uncle's safety. But in order to make sure they don't leave, he brings in his pet hamster, which of course he asked to guard them. But then proceeded to be told away by his father. But before he does this, who tells him that the ice cream truck is there, and Gideon immediately runs downstairs to have ice cream before sticking his hamster Cheekums on them. Cheekums, of course, is established to not be particularly bright, because Dipper quickly discovers that he doesn't really react to anything. Case in point, he just kind of pokes him with a cotton swab. Cheekums does not react. So he immediately tells Mabel that they need to think of some sort of plan to get out of there and rescue Stan before something happens. And of course, does point out that, you know, with how short they are, they're going to need to come up with some sort of thing. But does point out that at the very least, because they've been shrunken, they're now, you know, back to the same height. But Mabel quickly realizes that he's not actually. And then, you know, Dipper goes through Gideon's school bag to discover that, no, actually, they are, in fact, not the same height. Mabel is, in fact, once again, another millimeter taller, despite, you know, being shrunken down at the exact same time. Which, this is this point where, you know, Dipper becomes frustrated about the idea that, how? With Mabel just shrugging and saying that it must be another mystery. But Dipper just points out that it's just another reason why they need to get the flashlight and stop Gideon. So, I start thinking of a plan. Mabel's immediate plan is to ride Cheekums, but when they quickly discover that Cheekums is, you know, not really sapient enough to actually follow orders or pay attention to really anything, like they pointing out that he's, you know, a big old dummy-dum, as Mabel puts it, they then come up with another plan, which is to use pieces of Gideon's hair from his hairbrush to scale his desk and get out of his room. They do successfully do that, and of course Gideon is, you know, in the middle of his ice cream snack when he demands that his father clean him. At which point, you know, he then asks his dad if he can have a ride to the mystery shack, but Bud proceeds to remark that he has a lot of cars to sell. At which point he proceeds to tickle Gideon, who immediately insists that he don't tickle him, and throws his bowl of ice cream against the wall and shatters it. So, of course, this causes Gideon to, you know, tell him to never tickle him, and makes his father look at him before repeating what he told his father to say in these kinds of situations, which is, tickling is no laughing matter. At which point he gives him a kind slap on the cheek before his father then asks him if he still needs a ride to the mystery shack. But Gideon just insists, loudly declares that he'll take the bus and goes out and goes outside. And his father just remarks, you know, memories. While his wife is just like, just keep vacuuming. And yeah, you can't tell. Gideon's kind of a monster. Like that's become pretty apparent at this point. Gideon is terrible, and his parents live in fear of him. So yeah, he doesn't have the greatest home life. Like as I said, he's terrible. But ultimately realizing that, you know, Gideon's gonna leave without it, without them, they immediately sneak their way across the living room, out the doggy door, which Dipper, I'm not telling you, we never seen Gideon with a dog, I don't think. But it's interesting that he has one. Maybe they did, and Gideon did something to it. I would not be surprised. Like, it's Gideon. But they quickly realize they need to get somewhere higher up to actually, you know, find a way out of the dealership and everything else. So, with of course Mabel yet again making another short joke. But they eventually discover a massive novelty dollar flying dollar balloon that's, you know, as Bud refers to it later as his quote unquote sky high prices. So they climb up onto the balloon, and of course discover that, you know, Gideon is in fact waiting for the bus, and he sits down with Lazy Susan, who asks him what sort of thing he's off to go do. At which point he just remarks that he's going to annihilate his arch enemy's entire family, and she just kind of scoots slowly away from him on the bus stop, and then sort of remarks, "Oh, that's cool, yay!" So yeah, Gideon's a monster. Gideon really is just terrible, the worst. But of course they realize they need to catch up with him, because ultimately the bus is going to pick up Gideon and leave. But they eventually realize that they do have that Mabel, of course, points out that if only the dollar balloon could take them to the Mystery Shack. Which point Dipper remarks that maybe it can. At which point he once again uses his Swiss Army knife to cut the balloon free from its holding strings. And it then proceeds to fly off. Of course, much to Bud Gleeful's fear, because he realizes it just took off into the wind and is probably never coming back. So yeah, he lost a balloon. He lost his novelty balloon, and now he has to order a new one. And of course, Gideon meanwhile has gotten onto the bus, and Dipper and Mabel use the balloon to, you know, slowly chase after him, which is great. It's a fun little sequence. But ultimately, They all arrive at the Mystery Shack around the same time. And we do see a really funny gag where, you know, throughout the entire series up until this point, every time there's an establishing shot of the Mystery Shack, there's been a woodpecker in the background. We finally get to see the woodpecker in this episode. It attacks Dipper and he chases it and he shoos it off. It's just funny. But of course, they ultimately realize that they do need to get down there before Gideon can get in there and attack Stan. Which eventually Mabel does come up with an idea, and having stored one of her gummy koalas for later, she then uses it to drop it in Gideon's hair, which of course, right before he's about to enter the shack, and he, realizing he can't defeat Stan with, you know, his hair a mess, he immediately goes to find a reflective surface to fix his hair, eventually finding, you know, a shiny bathtub. Meanwhile, while he's distracted, Dipper and Mabel immediately climb down to try and use the flashlight to fix themselves. But then they start arguing with each other because, of course, while they're trying to get the flashlight back into position where they can, you know, fix themselves. Dipper then asks if Mabel is going to return them back to the same height. Which, of course, Mabel then argues back that Dipper should just accept the fact that she's just a little bit taller than him. Even though Dipper is, of course, frustrated because, you know, she's been calling him a bunch of names. At which point she tries to call him Little Dipper, but it's at this point where Gideon calls back and finishes her sentence and reveals that, you know, they would have defeated him if not for their constant sibling bickering. At which point he scoops him up in his hand, takes up the flashlight, and then declares that the shack is his. Seemingly shrinking Stan at first, before it's revealed that actually it's Seuss in Stan's fez. They show the fez dropping to the floor, but not Stan. And then when he picks up the fez, it's revealed that actually it's Seuss. It's a great little thing that keeps you in suspense. But also implies that Gideon's eyesight isn't all that great if he's able to confuse Seuss for Stan, because, you know, Seuss is obviously a little bit on the bigger side. Like, it is pretty obvious that they have different body types. So, yeah, Gideon's eyesight, not super great. But, ultimately, he winds up scooping up Seuss when he realizes he's been tricked and placing him in the jar with Dipper and Mabel. He then demands to know where Stan is, at which point, you know, Seuss then remarks that, you know, he'll never tell him where Stan is, and then ultimately tells him that Stan is, you know, in the parlor, which, of course, he then asks why he even thought it would be a good idea to say that, at which point, he tucks the three of them in his breast pocket, before picking up the flashlight again, and chasing after Stan, saying that he's coming for him. But ultimately it is revealed that, you know, Stan has finished his hall of mirrors, and when Gideon comes into the parlor, he has no idea where Stan is, because Stan is reflected in all of the mirrors from wherever he's standing. Which, of course, he then proceeds to remark that, you know, he was looking for someone to test out his maze of mirrors, but also remarks that Gideon's an idiot and he doesn't have much faith in him solving it. Which, of course, this causes, you know, Gideon to tell Stan to come back. At which point, he sticks it in his other pocket, and he sticks his flashlight in his other pocket and runs off after Stan. Meanwhile, Seuss then proceeds to point out that, you know, he really Seussed everything up. But ultimately points out, while Dipper and Mabel point out that it was their fault, pointing out that, you know, he didn't do anything and it was ultimately their bickering. But it's this point where Dipper does kind of confront Mabel about all the name calling she's been doing and wondering what all of that was about. And she does point out that it was actually, you know, because she's insecure about Dipper winning at basically everything. Dipper then proceeds to go through his notebook of all the times he's beaten Mabel, and sure enough, she's never won against him a single time at anything. So she then proceeds to point out that, you know, her being taller than him felt like she was, you know, finally winning something for once. So she does point, and of course this causes, you know, Dipper to realize that he's felt like a big jerk, to which point she, you know, makes another short joke about, you know, him being a quote unquote little jerk. And of course, he then laughs along with her joke, pointing out he walked into it. At which point, he asks if they're cool, and she of course gives him a sponge to kind of indicate that, yeah, they're cool. At which point, Seuss decides to get involved, and they decide to include him in that. So Pete's pretty happy. But realizing they need to stop Gideon before he shrinks Stan, they immediately figure out how to get the jar open with their combined teamwork, and, you know, eventually they do manage to climb onto Gideon's back, where they quickly climb around his back. They discover both how shiny his hair is, with a Dipper telling Mabel not to look directly at it, but also that Seuss starts making fat angels in the back of his neck, which causes Gideon to think it's some sort of termite, and he smacks it, not realizing it's Seuss. And Seuss falls off of him, telling the kids to write his story, before ultimately landing in a shag carpet. And Seuss, not particularly mad about it, because he finds a corn chip that he lost and decides, 5 second rule. But they, of course, eventually do make it to Gideon's other breast pocket. But it's this point where, you know, he eventually believes that he's found Stan and pulls it out to blast Stan in the face, but it's revealed to be his reflection in a mirror. And it almost hits Gideon. Like, Gideon ducks under the beam that he created, because it keeps bouncing off all the mirrors. And eventually it winds up hitting Stan's, you know, stuffed moose head that he has in the parlor. And of course Gideon becoming frustrated, breaks the mirror that he just flashed, which of course Stan appears then tells him to wash the merchandise. And realizing that he can use this to draw Stan out, he then proceeds to break every mirror he can find until he eventually finds the real one. And of course, Stan is not particularly happy about the fact that Gideon is breaking all of his mirrors, and then lies about how much they cost to kind of extort Gideon and make him pay up for all the mirrors he's broken. But telling him he's going to be paying for all of them. But Gideon then proceeds to pull out that flashlight and declares that that's not what's going to happen. At which point, Dipper and Mabel quickly realize that Stan is in trouble, but Dipper quickly comes up with an idea and tells Mabel to go to his armpit, which of course she's reluctant to do, but he tells her to just do it. But of course, it's at this point where, you know, Gideon seemingly is about to defeat Stan and has him cornered. With, of course, Stan being concerned as to what exactly it is he's looking at, realizing that Gideon has some sort of thing. But Gideon then proceeds to tell off Stan, pointing out that after every humiliation, after every little thing that he's done with him, after an old many years they've been at each other's throats, he's finally going to be able to defeat Stan, and that he'll have suffered the wrath of Gideon Gleeful. But then, Dipper and Mabel make it to his armpit and start tickling him, which of course causes, you know, his Gideon to kind of fall over and double down in laughter, because, you know, he doesn't like being tickled, but for good reason. He's very ticklish. So, and of course, Stan has really no idea of how to respond to what's happening with Gideon. He doesn't realize that Dipper and Mabel are tickling him, but ultimately, what winds up being a really funny bit between them is that, you know, Stan then proceeds to kind of console Gideon, pointing out that, you know, hey, you'll get me one of these days. I'm a formidable foe, though, so don't hold your breath. But, you know, yeah, you'll figure it out. One of your evil plans will work. Just, you know, workshop and buy some friends next time. It'll be fine. It's such a funny bit of just Stan being one of those characters who would definitely reconsole their arch nemesis on how their plan has horribly failed, even though Gideon's fail. Although he also points out that Gideon really needs to quote unquote get his issues in check. But then, when he realizes Gideon isn't gonna leave by his own, he kicks him out of the he kicks him and starts rolling him out of the parlor. So, and eventually out the front door. So with Dipper Mabel eventually being able to leap off of Gideon and sneaking back inside the shack. And of course, Gideon realizes he lost his flashlight in the process, so he refers to it as his light, at which point Dan just thinks he's talking about him and remarks that he's the light of his life too, rather sarcastically. At which point, he closes the door on Gideon and points out at some and remarks to it as some sort of freak show. He proceeds to walk back inside and goes to, you know, clean up all the mirrors that he's broken. But it's at this point where Dipper and Mabel, now successfully having disarmed Gideon and dealt with him, proceed to fix the flashlight with, of course, Dipper insisting that Mabel go first, even though Mabel isn't really points out that Dipper should go first, but Dipper insists and uses the flashlight to return her back to her normal height before she uses the flashlight to return Dipper back to normal. And then discovers that he let her keep her extra millimeter, with him remarking that she's earned it. At which point she tells that she's appreciated, making one last short joke as the episode ends, but ultimately concluding, which Dipper of course isn't enthused about. But it's this point where they then point out that they should probably destroy the crystal before it gets in the wrong hands again. At which point she breaks it under her foot, and seemingly happy about the fact that, you know, they've dealt with the issue, that they finally dealt with, you know, the problem of the episode. They proceed to go back upstairs, but then it is revealed that they accidentally forgot Seuss. And there's a really fun visual gag where he's created a message for them out of the broken glass from the mirrors that says, "Help Seuss," and he remarks that he's been trying to get their attention for a while. Which of course they quickly realize they need to help fix Seuss and need to get a lot of glue to, you know, Fix the crystal and restore Seuss back to normal. And of course, meanwhile, Gideon returns home. He's of course frustrated about the fact that his evil plan didn't work. But, and of course, his father then reconsoles him, pointing out that, you know, it'll be fine that he'll defeat Stan one of these days and get his revenge. But of course, Gideon remarks that it's not about revenge anymore, and that he wants the shack, the physical building. And then, of course, Bud asks him whatever he could want it for. It's at this point where Gideon remarks that, you know, it holds a secret that he couldn't possibly imagine. At which point, the episode ends with him asking his father for, you know, ice cream and, you know, kind of laughing to himself about it as he, you know, kind of maniacally while he's in between bites of ice cream. Meanwhile, the episode ends with the way it began, with, you know, Stan winning some sort of contest that he's won a big million dollar check, but unlike when Gideon happened, it was is legit, and Stan not really falling for the same thing, kind of pointing out that he's not going to fall for the same thing twice, just silently closes the door, at which point the guy reveals that, no, he was legit, and he's now going to go look for his next runner up, which is Old Man McGucket. We find out his first name is Fiddleford in this episode. And then McGucket appears. You know, the guy asks him if he just tells him they just won $1 million. And of course, McGucket's response is, "Dream come true," before eating the check. At which point, the guy just tells his cameraman to just cross the town off their list. And that's how the episode ends. So, overall, a fun episode. I very much enjoyed it. It's obviously, this episode kind of expands on Gideon and his home life, establishing that, you know, Gideon is a monster and his family is very much afraid of him. So yeah, that's not super great, but it is a fun, it is a good lesson, you know, about, you know, the Dipper, of course, being insecure about his height before ultimately realizing that, you know, he's kind of been gloating his victories over Mabel pretty much the entire time. So, of course, they kind of learn a little bit of a lesson in humility that, you know, they're not going to brag about all the little things that they succeed at. They're just going to, you know, just be like, okay, good game, you did a good job, great job, and just kind of celebrate each other's victories instead of, you know, being petty about it. So that's a good lesson to take away from that. But also, just Gideon is just a monster. That's what this episode is about, not anything else, just Gideon being terrible. But in case, that's gonna do it for today's episode and today's review, but we still got one more review for today. So thank you guys so much for watching. If you enjoyed, be sure to like, comment, and subscribe. Also, be sure to follow, and especially since we're going to be covering Gravity Falls all this month. So if you want to see more of that, be sure to follow me here so you can see all of those. Be sure to check out my Twitch. We stream Saturdays and Sundays. We are playing games all this month as well. So if you want to absolutely see all of those, again, link is down in the description. Please go check that out. I would appreciate it if you were going to do that. I mean, you can also watch them over here, but follow me over there. It gets me close to the Twitch affiliate, which gets me one step closer to doing this full time. Check out my Patreon. It helps fund future projects like this one, especially since this was a massive labor of love. So please go check that out. I would appreciate it if you were to do that. Go check out my Discord. We hang out there sometimes. And additionally, we have a Minecraft server over there. But the main reason I want you guys to go over there is that we are doing a watch-along of The Great Gatsby toward the end of the month. If you do not know the reference, read the Book of Bill. And also, finally, if you want to see more content from me, then be sure to check out the playlist linked in the end screen. The top video is the first one of these that the top playlist is the first one of these that I did, which was Courage Month, where I reviewed Courage the Cowardly Dog for the entire month of October. The one after that was Danny Phantom Month, where I reviewed the entirety of Danny Phantom for the month of October. That was the previous one of these that I did. If you have not seen either of those were also a massive project, so please go check both of them out. And finally, be sure to go and check out my Twitter for updates and those kinds of things. I would appreciate it if you were to go and do that. But in any case, thank you guys so much for watching. I'll see you guys, in the next video. Peace!